What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of JaAR. JaAR, for those of you that may be new, stands for Joe.
And Amy.
Review. It's our weekly show where we review the magic stories presented on Wizards of the Coast website, or in this case, last week, and for the next couple of weeks, we're going to be reviewing the Magic Story podcasts. If you missed last week's, you should go check it out up here. We'll probably be referencing it a lot, but not actually reviewing, because we did that already. So definitely go check that out if you missed it, just to give yourself a general idea of what these are. This week we had James Wyatt, who was here to talk about the art books for the different sets, namely Innistrad, Zendikar, and Kaladesh, and a little teaser of Amonkhet, etc. Excuse me. But also we, you know, and sorry, give credit where credit is due, hosted by Blake Rasmussen, again, as it was last week. My quick review in the beginning is, if you are interested in the art books, if you are interested in Dungeons & Dragons, I recommend that you go watch this one before, or listen to this one, excuse me, before watching our review of it. If you are not interested in those things, there's really not a lot of information here for you. And we'll be reviewing it, but I don't know if you have any other...
I mean, what I have to say is that if you are interested in Dungeons & Dragons and the art books, don't listen to this podcast, because it doesn't really talk about those things.
Okay.
Sorry.
That's fair, and we'll get into the full review, but... So that's kind of the review at the beginning, is that if you're really interested in that stuff and you want to hear things... I would say go listen to it first, and you would say not. So take your pick. Whoever has a more trustworthy face. Whatever. Either way, that's fine. So let's get into the full review itself. I will try to step on what you're about to say for just a second to say that. And please correct
that's fair,
me.
Because what I'm about to say is not nice.
Well, but I was going to say, please correct me though. What you are about to say has nothing to do with James Wyatt or Blake, nor their creativity. It's just about the content of this podcast. Is that fair to say?
I cannot say.
All right. Well, then...
I can't make that determination.
All right. So then what I'll do is... Go ahead.
Oh.
I love how I spoke right after I zipped my mouth shut. Please go.
There isn't much to say about this podcast. And the reason is because there wasn't much to this podcast. I maybe put a few too many eggs in the basket of this particular podcast. I was very excited for this one, because I love magic art, and I am... getting to a point now in us playing our campaigns where I'm starting to really get into different aspects of my character specifically, and different characters and how they interact and things like that.
In Dungeons & Dragons.
In Dungeons & Dragons, yes. Sorry, I didn't specify
that's
that.
That's fine, that's fine. They probably figured it out, but just in case.
Well, they might have thought I meant magic.
Fair.
Which is also true. Which is why this particular one should have been so interesting to me. I really wanted to hear his process. I wanted to hear from James Wyatt how he went about making up what he made up and doing... I just wanted to hear about the process. And I wanted to... Because I wanted to see an A... see a B, and see how we got from A to B. And he didn't really give us A, he didn't really give us B, and he didn't give us the process either. So I love James Wyatt. I
a lot.
I feel that what he has to say in panels and things like that is always poignant and fun. But this time, no, and I can't tell if it was that he wasn't prepared enough for the interview, or maybe the interview was kind of lacking in the sort of questions it asked, or maybe they just really wanted to kind of gloss over the process because they didn't want to go too deeply into it because they didn't want us as an audience or a community to be let into that too much because they didn't want it to be spoiled for us. But whatever the case, I was real disappointed. Like I said, maybe I gave it, you know, maybe I was too overly excited before it came out, and I didn't give it a fair enough shot that way, but I don't know. I was underwhelmed, and I was really hoping for a lot more detail, and it didn't have to be story-specific detail, which is what I felt like James Wyatt was trying to avoid. I felt like he was trying to keep from giving away too much story-specific information because we're not supposed to know that stuff yet if the stuff hasn't come out.
Mm-hmm.
I get it. But you can at least let us know what goes through your head when you're sitting there trying to create this, in my opinion, sort of complex compared to maybe even the other aspects of what the magic team has to create. Because the magic team has for so long...
The story team.
Well, no.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
I mean all aspects of Magic Gathering.
Oh, okay, okay, I'm sorry.
They have all gone about their specific jobs and their specific product
mm-hmm.
that they have to create. They, you know, they've been doing each one of those for much longer than they have the plane shift.
Correct.
Aspect. So this, in the scheme of Magic the Gathering, is a pretty new thing for them to have to work on. And as James Wyatt sort of glossed over in this podcast, as he basically said, he had to make up a lot of things because there was a lot of disconnect between the magic world that already existed and the D&D world, and he needed to figure out the intricacies of how to make those two coincide and work together correctly and in a manner that worked and made sense. And that was really interesting to me, but then he didn't explain any of that. He just basically said it. He was like, oh, well, this was hard, and I made stuff up, and okay. But he didn't say why or how. Or, yeah, there was no process in there, which is really what I was excited to hear about.
Okay. All right. So, I will say I was not kind of as passionate about it as Amy was. I will say, coming home today, getting ready to review this story, this podcast, I should say, usually when I'm on my way home and when we were getting ready to review Kaladesh or Aether Revolt or whatever the case may be of those stories, I was excited. I was like, let's see what's going to happen this week. And this time it was like, okay, you know, I'm going to listen to this podcast. I'm not super excited for it, but I'm ready. You know, let's listen to it. And if you didn't go listen to it, it was 17 minutes and 40 seconds long, which is almost half the time that last week's was. Now that's, I think, because the topic was so specific, as opposed to with Doug Beyer, where it was much more broad, and there was a lot more to delve into with Doug, whereas James was brought for a very specific reason to talk about very specific things. And the thing is, I think that there is a very vocal group of people out there, in a good way, who are fans of the art books, who are fans of the Planeshift stories, Innistrad, Zendikar, now Kaladesh, which comes out the day that this video is being released, And there are fans of those who enjoy that. My criticism for this one is that they talked a lot about the art books. They talked a lot about the Planeshift stories, and they talked a lot about D&D. What they did not talk a lot about, in specificity, were the magic stories. And yet, this is called the Magic Story Podcast. Now, I get it. I get how it connects. It connects because the art book comes from the world book, which is how the stories are written, and that's how they make the art books, and they, as Amy commented on, touched very briefly on the art books. I would love to, but I personally do not own any of the art books. We personally do not own any of the art books. It's a little expensive, and I would love to someday, don't get me wrong, and I'm sure hopefully we can get there at some point, because they are awesome, especially now that they've started introducing a lot of the idea of showing a lot of like the sketches and the preliminary photos and thing or art and things like that. And that should be really interesting. I'm looking forward to hopefully being able to delve into that. But because I don't own it, I guess, you know, fair shake to them just to let you guys know that we don't own the art books, but we have seen them, we have looked through them in local gaming stores, and it's not as... I feel like with the magic stories, you have a very particular group of people that you are targeting when you write your magic stories. Vorthos players. Vorthos people in general who enjoy the stories, who enjoy the art. Talking about the art books, you're narrowing your focus a little bit. Then you're also putting in D&D. Not every magic player plays Dungeons & Dragons. Not every magic player plays role-playing games. And that narrows the focus even further. I think that that's an interesting choice, and maybe not the best choice. I'm not a marketer, I couldn't tell you, but I wouldn't be surprised if less people were interested in this one than were in last week's, because it was so narrowly focused in terms of what it discussed. And if you're not aware of the fact that D&D is very focused on religion and belief systems with certain characters, it can be kind of a jarring process to be like, oh, so he did have to delve further into the humans on Zendikar to understand their beliefs, because in the cards, it doesn't matter. You see an angel and you're like, huh, that's interesting. Why is there an angel here? And then you move on, because it doesn't matter. In Dungeons & Dragons, it matters because you need to know what your motivations are as a human character for who you are worshiping. I don't know if that makes sense.
I mean, it sort of does, but I don't think it has anything to do with this podcast necessarily, because, like I said, I feel like this podcast really fell short of being... I mean, you keep talking about the fact that it was too specific, and I keep talking about the fact that it wasn't specific enough.
Well...
Because it lends, I don't know, I feel like it misleads you into believing that it's specific, and then it doesn't actually talk specifically about anything.
No, that's
it
fair.
It talks very generally about everything that makes it specific,
mm-hmm.
which may be an answer to what you're saying.
Right.
It might be Wizards saying, okay, well, this is our second one of these. Maybe Planeshift as a topic is what people asked for, and maybe that's why that's their second episode, but maybe we need to keep it really general and basic because we don't want to turn off too many people from watching the podcast or listening to the podcast,
mm-hmm.
if this is too specific a market that we're trying to, you know...
Right, and well, I yeah, and I guess what I was saying was that I thought that the topic was too specific of a topic, and yet the content wasn't all there with, you know, because the group of people that are going to be showing up are going to be people who want specificity because they understand the broad topic, right? They understand, because if you're showing up and you're like, cool, I want to know about the art book, I want to know about the stories, I want to know about Planeshift, I want to know about Dungeons & Dragons and how they all relate. If you know all of that minor background stuff to begin with, then you want it to get really deep in there and specific. But if you don't, right.
That's what I was expecting. Because from, I don't know, that's the impression they gave you from,
right.
From the fact that they were talking about this
right.
in the second one of these podcasts ever. Mm. Which goes back to your point of, maybe that wasn't the best idea. Maybe it would have made more sense to kind of do it the right way, I'll say, which isn't really fair, but the right way to me would be to get really specific, get really down to the nitty-gritty of every aspect of how those things relate in this podcast, but have this podcast happen much later than the second podcast ever that you
okay.
guys do.
No, that's fair.
You know?
I think, yeah, because I was going to say, no, that's a good point. Because you, and the problem with waiting on that is that you may just end up finding out that it's not worth it to do. Because as a company, and I don't pretend to know Wizard's strategies in terms of marketing and outreach and things like that, but my assumption, and that's all that it is, my assumption is that they would want to try to reach as broad of an audience now as they can, which is what Amy is saying. But my thought is that if they were like, okay, well, we'll get really specific, but then we'll put it out way later once we've gotten the ball rolling on this, is that I don't know if it's possible for them to gauge the kinds of people that watch, listen to, I'm going to mess that up every time, listen to their podcasts. And so if you put something out that specific and that kind of inside, you're going to only be focusing, as I said, on a very particularized group, and everybody else is going to be like, I don't really understand Dungeons and Dragons, so this is clearly not for me. Because
well, but they could have taken the time to start it off by saying, look, this is what we do. We created Planeshift as a Dungeons and Dragons aspect that you use the art book for and blah, blah,
mm-hmm.
blah, and just explain that to people who don't know that, but then get into the nitty-gritty of
that
all-in-one podcast if they don't get super detailed with it.
Well, I was going to say, that's not my exact point. My point is having a background in D&D, which, beneficially for us having watched this, we have that at least introductory background of understanding that in Dungeons & Dragons, I'm going to keep using Faith as an example. One, because Doug Beyer last week mentioned that that's what James is best known for on the story team, that is what he is known for in terms of his strengths, but also because it's something that he himself brought up in terms of something that he had to do for Zendikar, which was to create out on the fly, as Amy put it, expanding on the belief systems of humans on Zendikar, which we hear nothing about in the stories because they're not really a necessary topic of discussion. But when you get to the D&D world and you need to know their faith because some of their magical abilities come from their faith, then you need to have that discussion and know those answers. But for a person who's not familiar with D&D, you might just be like, I don't understand why that's a problem. Because James never said their magic powers come from their faith, or some of their magic comes from their faith or from their god. And because that wasn't mentioned, because, as James properly put it, he was in the world of Dungeons & Dragons for over 10 years, and so for him, it may not necessarily be second nature to be like, oh, people don't necessarily understand that, let me explain it.
Right.
And so going through it, and maybe you could argue that that's Blake's job to kind of look at it from the direction of somebody who doesn't know that, and so James is there as an expert, so to speak, and so he's talking about all that heavy stuff, and Blake is there to say, well, wait, you talked about this, maybe explain that a little bit more. Maybe.
Well, and that goes
but,
back to what I said about it kind of seemed like they just weren't prepared for this interview to occur. It didn't seem like James Wyatt really had the answers, and it didn't seem like Blake really had the questions. Like, it just seemed... Honestly, it seemed like both the questions and the answers were not asking and answering the right questions.
Right. And you know what? I would say that I find that surprising, because as I pointed out in last week's video and as I thought in last week's, listening to last week's podcast, Blake, I think, did a really good job last week of taking what I assume is, or were, many, many questions that he received on Twitter and compiling them into a really good interview. In terms of start to finish, it told a story, it expanded, it was not jumping from A to Z to B to Y. Like, it was, it flowed nicely, A, B, C, D, all the way through with Doug, of asking him these questions, getting the answers. And with James, I guess you could say that he did that, where he asked the questions in sort of a linear fashion, but, and I don't blame James for this necessarily, but there were a couple of times where James was like, oh, I actually don't remember the answer to that. And it was...
Well, but yeah, I feel like in those instances, the question that was being asked didn't really relate to the overall topic of what the podcast was supposed to be about.
Mm-hmm.
And so maybe James was really prepared, but he was prepared for a different interview.
Okay.
Or maybe Blake was really prepared, but what he was prepared to ask was in no way what James was prepared to answer. So I think maybe there needed to be more communication between the two.
Right, a kind of a preparatory thing beforehand of, these are the questions I'm going to ask. And honestly...
Maybe too, I mean, you mentioned how last week he compiled questions on Twitter very effectively.
Yes, I thought
so. Maybe he just didn't get a lot of great questions on Twitter this time around.
Right. It could have just been...
He worked off of what he had, mm-hmm. but maybe he... You know, maybe he doesn't know anything about Planeshift or whatever.
Hmm.
But, you know, I'm not going to presume what he does or
right.
doesn't know.
Right.
But maybe if he's just working off of the questions that he got off of Twitter, maybe those questions weren't really the questions that needed to be asked to fulfill the topic of the podcast.
Fair enough.
That I think that's why I'm so disappointed. I don't think I'm disappointed in Blake or in James, or think that they're just dumb or didn't say the right thing.
Which I said at the beginning.
I just felt like the topic really spoke to me, and I feel like what was talked about didn't really fit the topic.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, it was incongruous, kind of. You went in expecting one thing and got something else.
Yeah.
And sometimes that can be a good thing. In this case, obviously, Amy is saying
for me,
wasn't.
It wasn't. I'm not saying that it's a bad thing for everybody, because like we said before, maybe it's a good thing for people who really don't understand Planeshift or D&D or how humans in Zendikar matter worth the damn.
Right.
How the art books play into all of this. Like, maybe it caters better to people who don't really know and or care about most of that stuff.
Right.
And maybe it makes them care a little bit more, or maybe it just, you know, gives them a fun thing to listen to for 17 minutes and not necessarily care about the fact that they don't know the details of this specific thing.
Right. Yeah, well, and I was going to say, I think that's really important, right? Because, as I said, we are standing here from the perspective of understanding, at least cursorily. I mean, I've been playing D&D for years now. Not many, but 5 or so years.
Has it been that long?
I think so.
Wow.
Maybe 4 or 3, but
okay.
no less than 3 years, because we moved on to a different RPG, but, you know, in between. But no, I started playing D&D, I would say, at least 4 or 5 years ago. And
so,
which
for me is what, like 2?
Right. And, I mean, through discussions with me, even more technically, for as much as you understood from those. But regardless, that's our background, and that's where we are coming from. So we have read through D&D, we know the character tropes, and we know a lot of the rules and stuff like that.
He does. I know.
but what I'm saying is we were able to follow along to say that it wasn't specific enough. What I'm curious about is, what about you guys? If you've gotten this far in the video, obviously you care enough. Take a minute, if you don't mind, you know, sharing this with us. Let us know in the comments. Were you aware of D&D before this? Did you feel like stuff was over your head? Did you feel like you didn't need to have a D&D background? Or did you have a D&D background? Do you agree with what Amy said? Or do you think that it was just enough and you were super entertained by it? Let us know what you think. Keep giving your feedback.
Yes, please. Especially on this one. I know I say that in every video, but especially in this one, because obviously I'm pretty passionate about this one because I had a lot to say.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, leave your opinions in the comments.
Please.
And we talk about specificity a lot in this particular episode, but be specific because I want to know.
Yeah.
I want to know what your background information was in terms of Planeshift, D&D, Magic the Gathering as a whole, the art books, all of those things, and then just tell me what you thought and why.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, please. It's important to us because I'm curious to hear if there is really a balancing for people who may not have had that kind of a background, even though we do. So we're coming at it from that perspective, and so we can only review it with that lens. Like I said, I can try to think like a person who doesn't fully understand and say, that might be confusing if I didn't get it, but I can't know that.
And maybe that's what the two of them should have done.
Well, that's what I was going to say. That's why I commented that I think that could have been something that Blake did, is said, you know, hey, James, why don't you explain that a little bit more or whatever. Regardless, this was week two. Last week, what they did at the end was say, hey, in text underneath it, hey, next week we're talking to James Wyatt about the art books. This week they didn't do that. This week at the end they said, hey, Amonkhet comes back March 29th. I'm almost certain what Blake said in his Daily Magic update, where he announced that the podcasts were coming out, he said that there would be, I think he had the first 3 weeks filmed already. Oh, I'm sorry. In the podcast, he said that Mel Lee is coming next week.
Yes.
I apologize. So we will see Mel Lee next week. It seems like she will have... We will hear from Mel Lee with Blake next week. It seems like she has a meatier topic, which maybe will last a little bit longer. And then maybe, you know, next week... because I don't think we... maybe we talked about it last week, maybe we didn't. I thought last week 31 minutes and change was an amazing amount of time. I thought it was not too long, it was not too short. This one I thought was too short. Even before we started just looking at it, I was like, 17 minutes, that's really short. Because again, almost half the time of last week's. So...
luckily, I wasn't disappointed before it started.
we shall see where we go next week. Either way, we will be here next week to review it. I just want to give a quick drop at the end here. If you can look at the title of the middle, this is episode number 50 of JaAR. That's really awesome to me. The fact that we've been here for 50. I understand that if you guys are on YouTube and you watch a lot of popular YouTubers, semi-popular YouTubers, popular magic YouTubers, the amount of views that we get per JaAR video are nothing impressive. We're working on it. We're trying to get our name out there. Please feel free, if you like this series, to share it around.
Yeah.
50 is impressive to me. I hope it's impressive to you. If you like it, let your friends know. You know, if that's not too much of an inconvenience, we would really appreciate it. We're sharing it around as much as we can and where we can, but we would love your help if you like what we're doing. If you don't, that's fine, and let us know that because we want your feedback. But if you've gotten this far, I suspect that you do, and thank you so much for all of your support to this point and beyond, because in no way is this the end.
And basically, going back to what we were saying before...
Sorry.
The specificity of just JaAR in general doesn't necessarily allow for us to have a ton of views on each video. And so I think we have somewhat realistic expectations as to the audience that we actually could acquire watching these videos. But if it's something that you know someone is interested in, please share our channel with them.
Yes.
And also, please leave your feedback in the comments, because we read them. I really do care what you have to say about these things. I really can only speak for myself. I can't speak for you.
It's fair. I also care. I do. I read them. I care. I appreciate each and every comment. Because you've taken the time to do that. If you hit the like button, if you hit the dislike button, I appreciate it either way. If you hit the dislike button, I always want you to tell me why, so that if you walk away unsatisfied, I want to know why you were unsatisfied, and maybe we could fix it in the future. But regardless, either way, if you take the time to do that, we appreciate it. If you take the time to subscribe because you like what we do and you want to hear more, that helps a lot. That number, our view count, everything like that has gone up tremendously since we started this series way long ago. Because it wasn't exactly a year, I know 50, 52 weeks, but it also wasn't exactly weekly. So yeah, we're coming up on a year of JaAR.
It feels like a long time ago, though. It does. And if you watch our older videos, it looks like a long time ago, too. Okay?
She's commenting on our looks. We get old.
Well, but also, like, the quality of the videos, I feel like.
Fair. Because we're slowly and steadily improving, and I'm sure maybe in some of your opinions, we've got a long way to go. But regardless, this is episode 50. Thank you so much for getting us to this point.
Yes.
I have had a blast with the first 50, and like I said, I'm not planning on stopping anytime soon. Because I'm looking forward to Amon Kat. What I will say, you sounded like you were going to say something. Are you okay? Or are you
wanna... Yeah, you do it to me all the time.
Go ahead if you want.
No, I don't even know what I was going
to
say anymore.
Okay. If you come up with it, feel free to interrupt me. All I was going to say is, speaking of subscribing, if you subscribe, we have more than just JaAR coming out every week. This past Monday, we had a booster box opening video come out. That's going to be up here. You can go check that out and watch it, or just go to our channel and check out all the cool stuff that we have. We have a lot of Aether Revolt product openings. I will say, if you click that now, what is probably that little eye because it went away, if you click on that to go watch that booster box opening, towards the beginning, there was a nice surprise in that video. So enjoy that. I sure did. Check that out. That was really cool. Let us know what you thought of this in the comments down below. You can check us out on Facebook and Twitter. Those links are down in the description box below.
Let us know what you think about the fact that we have 50 JaAR videos now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, does that seem like a lot to you? Does it seem like not a lot at all?
Right.
Do you think we have improved making these videos? I feel like you guys leave comments on occasion, nice things, whatever, but try and leave comments that are specific to the videos, because I want to hear what you have to say about what we talk about in the videos.
Yeah.
You know, general nice things are generally nice, but...
And I appreciate them.
Leave some meaty comments, okay?
Thank you guys so much for our first 50, hopefully 50 and 50 and 50 more down the line. This has been another episode of JaAR. Thank you for continuing to, with us, show off your...
Hashtag Vorthos Pride.
As I said, this has been episode 50. I have been Joe...
And I'm Amy.
And as we always say on the Geek for All YouTube channel, in whichever video of ours you watch next, we will see you all next time. Thanks, everybody.